sorry to interrupt you.
That's good. Well, I already said all the good stuff. So,
so say welcome. Congratulations on finishing the spring. Okay, there we go.
Yeah, there we go. So as we think about all modes as a mindset going forward, I think Ellen is exactly right. It's about thinking about the needs of the students and thinking about the place in time in terms of what's possible. And I'm looking at the faces here. Many of you are very experienced educators, whether you're staff or faculty. You are involved in this work all the time. And you know how important it is to continue to adjust and to meet students where they are and to adapt, right? That you take on different activities, modalities, approaches, concepts as you get real-time feedback from students about what they are, what they need from you. And you don't enforce this overly strict or preconceived framework at the expense of individual learning, right? That there are so many innovations now that are happening on campus. And so as we think about all modes work going forward, I want you to think about it on a couple of levels, and then I'm happy to have a conversation before I go to see if there are other things that you want to talk about or to share with me so that I know. But we have kind of the logistical aspects of all modes, which make us feel like it's about technology or it's about how many fully remote students am I going to have in my class, or what kind of other disruptions are there likely to be during the semester, right? Those feel like technical things and things that are somewhat outside of one's control. But I also want to remind you that the historical and cultural groundedness of a teacher with a group of students creating an environment for learning, that is the sacred space. And that is the space that you oversee. That's the space that you have ultimate influence over. And I want to encourage people to rediscover that, because I think the last year has made everyone feel like I don't have control over anything, right? There's somebody telling me what I need to do or what I can't do, or there's fear around every corner. And I really do think that we are very close to getting back to that sense of agency and influence that makes our model of education so vibrant and so effective. So we will continue to work through the technical and logistical pieces. Those of you who heard my presentation last night know that we're going to work hard to document who's going to be fully remote and give faculty time to digest that information and plan accordingly. And through CTLM, we're going to continue building out the resources to help faculty who are in those situations to help them adapt. But my hope is that it's not just because you have fully remote students in your class, or it's not just because you're being tapped for this additional consideration, but that you continue the innovation and the creative work that you've been so successful with this year and continue to build it out so that all modes ready for us a year from now or 3 years from now will ideally grow into becoming a strategic advantage for the university, that our adaptability with pedagogy, our inclusiveness with not just how we teach, but what we teach, becomes a signature element of this institution. It's on its way because of the work that you've been doing, but it won't get there if we don't stick with it and focus on it intentionally. And so that's really all I wanted to share in terms of prepared remarks. And Ellen, is there time for 5 minutes of conversation if people have thoughts they want to share?
Yes, absolutely. We're doing well.
Okay.
We have until 10 o'clock.
All right. Any thoughts, reactions, contributions, questions, concerns? Yeah, Catherine.
Hi, Jeff. I did not hear your presentation at the Senate meeting. So my question might have been answered by that.
That's okay. Go ahead and ask. Go for it.
So I am someone who has taught remotely all year, and I teach theater for the rest of you. And I avoided the acting classes because I could not reconcile how to teach theater in person. I mean, to me, which is a living personal art. Right. My question is, I have found in some of my classes, playwriting, Shakespeare seminar, a bunch of things that I can do the all modes. I can even do, I'm doing an async class. I really love the different modalities being offered. But when it comes to hands-on learning classes, it's so important for students to show up and understand the rigor of showing up. Mm-hmm. And what I am seeing in my, even my Zoom classes or asynchronous classes, that is what I'm most concerned about, that students think it's okay not to be present. And you have, I mean, presence is really the depth of everything that all learning, truly. So my question is how to allow the permission of an all modes situation when really I usually actually grade even on participation and showing up in my art form. So I don't know how to reconcile those things, and will the university be able to give us any guidelines on that?
Yeah, well, we're definitely going to back you up, first of all, just to let you know that, again, to reiterate your authority and influence over your domain, which is the class, the classroom. And last night, a couple thoughts. Last night, I did share some of the planning thinking that we've been working through around who's most likely to be requesting remote, fully remote engagement. And these are the populations that we believe are least likely to request it. That's first-year students, on-campus residents, so students living on campus workers, athletes, students in lab science, fine arts, theater, and most graduate programs, right? So we believe that the imprinting of the pandemic is not permanent for most people, that most people are eager to get back or to join us for the first time. Keep in mind that we've got a whole group of now second year, soon to be second year students who've never taken classes on campus, massive number. So this is why we want students to have to request permission for fully remote participation, because in theater, for example, and we've had many conversations, Jonathan and Mark and I over the months, that this past spring was an experiment to get theater students back in person, because that is indeed the preferred methodology and pedagogy. And that will also probably be the signature element of that program going forward. So all modes doesn't mean the same thing for everyone. I will say that the all modes ready mindset in theater, which you may have already adopted pre-pandemic in some instances, is to not use physical presence as the only requirement for engaging a world of expression and exploration that's out there, right? So we've seen so much emerge in terms of the ability to bring in folks that you would never be able to bring in physically, or the ability to create laboratory and experimental spaces that are primarily situated within technological spaces to push the practice, right? So the idea isn't to reject technology and go back to even like a 19th century version of the craft, but it would be to say, use the all modes pieces where it makes sense and demand presence where it makes sense. And like I said, you will have the backing of the university to help with that. One caveat, you may have noticed that it's a crazy enrollment world out there. Everyone's jockeying for position. There's a lot of poaching going on. There's a lot of transferring. There's a lot of hyper-competitive energy among institutions out there. And you know what, if we have a senior theater student who is really struggling with being on campus regularly, are we ready to walk away from that student right now and say, well, then you just need to leave if you can't be here? I don't want to be that cut and dry about it right now, because we need students. We need to accommodate wherever we possibly can, but not to the deleterious extent that it would really compromise the education for other students. So again, this is why we want students to apply for remote participation, and we're going to work through it case by case by case. Sorry, that was a long answer.
No, that's helpful. Thank you. And it may be that not all classes are for all students.
That's exactly right.
Because there are some classes that just need to be in-person hands-on. So.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. And Ellen is reminding me that I probably should give you the headline of the presentation last night, which is there will be a memo coming out probably on Monday about a vaccine policy for fall. So indeed, we will have one. It will have the not so subtle twist that of language that says we will require a vaccine once the FDA fully approves a vaccine. And in the meantime, we're strongly encouraging it. And we're telling people be proactive, get vaccinated, because there have been now a number of formal applications for full FDA approval, and it could come at any time. So that's going to be a feature of the fall. We're working on systems to document student, faculty, and staff vaccination status, and then build procedures and policies that allow for us to leverage the freedom that that comes with, right? And you're already seeing it unfold out there in the outer world. And we will watch very closely what happens over the next couple of months. But like I said, all indications are that what's happening now is working. And at least in our region, COVID is losing and humans are back in the lead, and we want to keep us there.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Are there other questions for Jeff?
I have a question.
Hi, Lisa.
Hi. I was also not at the Senate meeting, so maybe this came up, but this is piggybacking off of what Catherine just asked. Will we be able to designate some classes as in-person only? I've been in touch with my dean a little bit about our video production classes that just, the students don't have the software, they don't have the computers to do it, you know, like would be an instance, yeah.
We have to get to that place, right? And when we think about fall as this kind of awkward transition phase, right, where we're now experimenting with so many new ways of thinking about the pandemic, right, there have been no reruns in this thing. It's everything's a new episode. But when we think about going forward, Lisa, absolutely, it is very much related to what Catherine was raising. And if, for example, in media production or video production specifically, or other highly technical fields. I also think of lab science, chemistry, especially, where we may be evolving to a place where we just create ways to involve students remotely, but not in the core classes that we're offering, not in the core majors that we're offering, that we would purposely build almost versions of some of these classes so that students can engage in it. But it will be years for us to build out a fully remote version of any of these things, right? And that will be an evolutionary process. So we're just, right now, we're still looking one semester at a time with the rollout of what fall looks like. And we kind of have to stay on the tops of our toes regarding changes with the pandemic. So I don't think we're out of the woods yet, but yes, we need to be ready to say that. Again, I will say that if we end up having a senior student in media and communication who is, for whatever reason, has a legitimate reason to try to participate remotely, we will do what we can to figure that out. but that's not an institutional level posture, meaning that we're not going to make that possible for everybody. It's going to be a case by case by case.
Hey, Jeff, I have a quick question.
Yeah.
When students apply to be remote, are they going to be asked to talk to their instructors first, or is there just a central person who will be deciding this? Because my only concern is that the student not be promised something from one level that I'm unable to deliver at my level. So that when they come to me, I say, oh no, you're not going to be able to do that. And then they say, oh, but the remote guru said I would.
Yeah, excellent question. Indeed, the spirit that we have here is kind of the opposite in the sense that we're going to collect and manage that information centrally, but with every student who requests, the very next thing we have to do is then check their schedule and check in with their faculty. Because some faculty will welcome all modes readily, and we need to make sure we are fully engaging in that option. And the idea that, again, this is why I thought it was important last night and today to share the early thinking about who's probably not going to be asking for remote, which is most people, right? We really do think that the number of students requesting fully remote participation is going to be small. So, but yeah, great question. Yes, we will absolutely depend on the answers of those faculty to determine the ultimate answer to the student.
I know we're running a little short on time, but I just wanted to add in there as somebody who I taught all modes in a studio situation this semester, and it was impossible to offer the same content to both groups. So I ended up teaching two different syllabi, one that was online and one that was in the studio, which is really not sustainable. And so I think that ability to be able to find a way to make sure that there's some courses where it's just not, mm-hmm. it's not possible to teach two groups of students at the same time and the same syllabi. And be able to present that to students.
That's right. And Karen, the way you describe that brings up an interesting possibility. This is not going to be possible in all situations, obviously. But if there is a critical mass of students requesting fully remote in a particular area or a particular class, then it could make really good sense to just split the class and create a fully remote version of the class and a fully in-person version of the class. Now, enrollments and student demand and resources all would have to line up for that approach. But again, the idea here is that we're making those individualized decisions in more or less real time, right? So that we can't set policy and practice up front right now. We don't believe that we're going to use the information gathered from students as that first step to then consult with faculty and find the best path forward. So thank you, Karen, for jumping in embrace that experiment this past semester. And we need to benefit from what you've learned and apply that going forward. So thanks again for doing that.
I see that there are a few other questions. I'm wondering if part of what we can do is continue to collect those questions so that this isn't the only time when we get to hear back from Jeff about some of these issues. The one question that I see in the chat is like has to do with timing. And my sense is that from what you're saying, Jeff, is that we're going to be hearing more about that timing soon, right? Like when students are going to be asked to make these decisions and when advisors will know which courses might have remote students in and all of those things.
Yep. Yeah. There's going to be a lot of scramble work happening in the next week or two to nail all those things down, get the processes figured out, and then launching. And as you might imagine, we're nervous about people getting back to us and people's availability. And for faculty, we will be communicating with you through the summer. So please do keep an eye on your inbox. All right.
Great. Thank you so much.
Good luck today. Thanks again, Ellen, for all that you're doing with CTLM. Thanks to all of you for everything you all are doing. It's really exciting to imagine what's possible. Thanks again.
Okay. Thanks for being here. I also just want to mention that many of you post questions on your registration and that those questions were also shared with the provost office. And so if you're not, if today you're not feeling like those questions are getting answered, they're being collated and sent to the all modes team so we can continue to try to address them. I want to just take a minute to say none of what we've been doing this year would have been possible without our instructional technology experts. And I'm about to introduce one of the most famous ones, Tim Beloff. And just say publicly, I said it in the chat, that we couldn't have done any of this without DLS. And Tim, you're gonna have to tell me what the new name of your division is, because I can't quite hold on to it. But Tim's gonna give us a short update. Some of you may know that maybe a month ago, the math department invited Chris Cerski to come share some of the ways that he's been teaching remote and face-to-face students in his courses this semester. And there is a bootleg video that I hear you have to pay a lot of money for to see him talk about that. No, and that video, there is a video of that that has been circulating a little bit among, you know, informally. I want you to know that that video is, we're gonna find a way for that to be made available so that people can see a more in-depth, and we're gonna hear from Chris in a little bit in a shorter version of that. But just to know that all of the IT folks have really gone above and beyond, even before we had the major crash this spring. I can't imagine anyone working harder to make this happen. So Tim, I'm turning it over to you so that you can tell us a little bit about some of the ways that classrooms are going to be differently prepared for this potential new kinds of combinations of maybe mostly face-to-face students and some remote students.
Yeah, so for those that don't know, I'm Tim Beloff. I'm the Director of Information Technology Support Services. So over the last couple months, almost a year now, we've realigned IT to kind of be a little bit more strategic in the way that we support everybody on campus. And my area is information technology support services, which involves, help desk, classroom support, and as well, but still working very closely with Valerie and Tori and their roles with everything else as well. So I just wanted to kind of briefly talk a little bit about what we're looking at doing this summer in the classrooms and a lot of the standard classrooms that we have on campus. We have just about 40 or just under 40 traditional style classrooms that we are going to be adding technology into this summer. Basically, we're calling them confidence monitors. They're basically large television screens that are going to be placed in the back of or side of, depending on how the room is set up, many of these classrooms that are going to be acting as like a second monitor. So the classroom still will have the projection screen or monitors that are in there as the primary place that the classroom might be oriented towards or faced towards. And that is a mirrored reflection of what is on the podium. But the second monitor in the back of the room will basically be like a second monitor that you might have in your office or something like that. So if you're used to using two monitors with Zoom, this is nothing more than basically adding that in so that if you are having students remotely in your classroom in a Zoom style setting, you'll be able to have that gallery view of your students in the back of the room on that monitor, as well as still having your presentation in the front. And then so you can see those students and then they can still see in the classroom because they'll be in most of these spaces or all these spaces, there is a camera in the room and microphones already installed in those rooms. One of the other pieces that will be added into those spaces as well is a webcam that will be attached to the podium as well. So there'll be two cameras in every room. And that'll be a way for you to change views or change vantage points. So if you need a different view or if students need to have a different view, or if you need to do something a little bit more hands-on or a little bit closer up or just change the view of the room, it'll be as simple as in your Zoom meeting, just changing the camera that is registered there. So currently I have two cameras on my set up here. So I have one on my actual computer and I have a separate USB one, which is the one I'm using right now. And I can just click on the where the video is and actually change the camera. So you'll see me change real quick in real time to a different camera. And you can do that similar setup this summer, or after this summer, when we install that second camera in these classrooms. For everybody's understanding, this is the list of classrooms that we are looking at editing or adding those things to those standard classrooms. Not every classroom obviously is going to allow us to add these confidence style monitors or these 55 inch TVs into the rooms to do that, just because they're either labs or studios and things like that. We are working with, we'll continue to work with those departments to figure out other alternatives for that, whether it is just adding in an additional camera, or because some of those rooms don't have cameras, but we will continue to work with them, and we'll be reaching out to you when Matt gets back. Actually, Matt is away for the week, so Matt got a good, well-deserved vacation on his end as well. So with that being said, one of the things that we're going to be doing over the summer is also setting up a sample classroom prior to that. So this week, actually, I will be working with our other classroom support folk and setting up a sample classroom that will look very similar to what that list of classrooms is going to look like. We'll have a TV in the back of the room. We'll have the camera set up. We'll have everything kind of squared away. And then we'll be able to allow people to start either visiting that or coming into that, so that they can kind of get an idea and see what it's going to look like, with the overall goal that all of these spaces will be ready to go before August 1. And we will start having trainings during the month of August for faculty and staff that are teaching to show them how those spaces will work. We'll have emails going out that'll have photos of those spaces. They'll have videos of, you know, kind of a walk around video of how that's going to look. And then we will also be reaching out department by department to kind of offer, you know, even building by building, open drop in sessions to the rooms in those buildings. So not every room will be kind of open, but like we might just take a room in Brubaker and say, if you teach in Brubaker, meet us here this day, and we can walk you through each of those as well. I think that is all that I had, and I wanted to give a few minutes and give me about 5 minutes for questions here. So Jill, I saw your question. We'll reach out and we'll talk. Any other questions about how the classrooms are going to be set up, or, you know, or concerns about that?
Tim, if we think a classroom should be on that list and it's not, like I'm thinking about Murphy 108 that we kind of turned into a lab, but I think we're going to be turning it back into a classroom. Do we just get in touch with you, or have you already thought about everything?
We've kind of thought about, I mean, we're obviously going to be open. If we have the ability to add that in, we can certainly try to do that. So please feel free to reach out to us. Just send us an email, and we can work through that.
Okay. All right. Yeah. I'm still not sure what's happening with that room, but I'll let you know.
Yeah, definitely. Janet?
Hey, Tim.
Tim, if there is a classroom space that's on your list that will be used, say, in the July timeframe, would it be possible to get it set up with this extra confidence monitors before that date, or is that not possible?
So the goal is to actually have them in hopefully before July, so we're there. But I mean, so it's very possible. It just depends on our work with the vendor. It also depends. I mean, we're all experiencing, you know, some of that strain of the global supply shortage. So there's a chip shortage coming for technology pieces. So the hope is that all that stuff will be in before then, and hopefully be able to be installed. But again, we're at the mercy of supply chain and the vendor getting their ability to be able to be on campus to get that stuff installed. With the hope of that being right or being able to be done. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Steve, I think, was that you that someone?
Yeah, just a quick question, Tim. So I use a whiteboard, and I've tried Panopto in the past, and it doesn't have the resolution to capture writing on a whiteboard. Is that something you could individualize to have a camera set up to do that?
Either the hope of that little webcam could be turned to the whiteboard, so we can work with you on that and see if we can get something set up in that vein for those spaces. And we can work to kind of individualize like that if we need to add, you know, you've worked great with us in the past of equipment. We can either do a webcam and a tripod for you. So if you need to actually move that, so it sits in a good space for you to do that, we can look at that. There are lots of options for that.
Thank you.
In that vein, also, we do have, we did get a bunch of iPads over this past year that are will be available for faculty to check out that will enable you to join your meeting so you can use the built-in iPad functionality that has a whiteboard sharing feature that could then be shared and seen in classrooms as well as by students that are attending remotely. And those iPads do have Apple Pencils attached to them. They are the iPad mini, so they are a little bit smaller, but they do, it would enable you to do that same kind of setup where you can annotate directly with handwritten. So it's not like clunky with using a mouse, you're actually using the an Apple Pencil stylus.
Hi, Tim.
Yeah, go ahead.
I hate to be the worst case scenario person, but knowing how life goes, are you thinking ahead to extra staffing a different way for the help desk? Because if you're in the front of a classroom and something doesn't work, your whole class goes down the drain very quickly. So I'd like a 911 to the help desk, to IT or something
so
like that.
So one of the ways that we, with this restructuring of our department, we were able to actually get hire in two new classroom technology people. They are, some of you might have met them already, Phil Raskalchek and Buzz Lombardi. They are both working in the help desk now as well, getting up to speed, but we will have coverage. The goal is to have coverage basically from 8 to 8 every day for classroom emergency and issues so that they're responsible, you know, if there is a classroom emergency, we'll be able to get over there and handle that as quickly as possible.
And there's a, we're gonna need to shift gears soon, but there's a question on in the chat that from Christian Patchell. I don't know if you wanna say it, but Christian, do you wanna articulate your question?
Yeah, just real quick. I was wondering where the status of the internet on campus, the network on campus. I'm still getting some complaints from students that might be in the dorms. And I was wondering if there's been any discussion about recommending or suggesting certain laptops to students university-wide. We're focusing a little bit on them as students in the classroom, which is great, but we also have to think about the user and them using laptops and what kind. That's been a hurdle for a lot of classes.
Yeah, so for the internet, that is an ongoing piece that is being updated and worked on. You know, we know we have a lot of reported issues in certain areas, and we keep reporting those and keep getting them. You know, we keep trying to work on it. It's really difficult to kind of piecemeal fixes while either classes are going on, and without, you know, some of this might require us to take down sections of the internet for a longer period of time to get stuff fixed, especially with students in dorm rooms. We can't, you know, we can't take it down to get it fixed right away with them still there. So that will be addressed hopefully during the summertime to make sure that that is in a much better state come the fall. That's something that I've heard a lot of issues with, and we want to make sure that that gets corrected appropriately. There is a recommendation on the IT website for recommended computer usage. So if, and I'll grab a link to that and throw that in the chat here so you have that. And if there is recommended departmental pieces that you want to add to that, we can also update that. I know we have had a couple departments, you know, have certain recommendations for computer setups that they wanted to make sure that were listed out, but we do have a recommended configuration for students. So I'll get that a link for you.
Tim,
I know June had his hand up. I want to make sure.
Just a quick question. I mean, one comment and quick question. Yeah, I used the Apple Pencil and the iPad Mini that Tim is talking about. Worked out really great when I did the Jamboard and writing my notes. It was awesome. So my question is, I think it relates to the hardware that we've been talking about, but especially like some of our classes where instructor has to move around the space, like the lab or studios. I think not only having a multiple camera, but also like wireless earphone and microphone so that it doesn't go through my laptop where I'm be like 10 feet away, but you know, it goes straight. So I think those type of equipment will be also really essential.
Okay.
Super. I realize it's hard to move on, but thank you, Tim, for those updates. And you'll see on the Jamboard that Tim has said if people have specific questions about specific rooms, the best thing to do is to email the help desk, right? That's sort of the central place to send emails around technology, in particular classrooms. But my guess, Tim, is that there's gonna be much more information shared in the coming weeks about both where things are with particular classrooms and also people's ability to get into classrooms to try things out in August. Great. So for me, this next part feels like the most exciting part, where we get to hear from some of our colleagues who've been doing more of this combined face-to-face and remote student teaching. I want to tell you a little bit about how we're going to make it happen. We have about an hour set aside to hear from four people, to hear four different case studies. I feel like in my conversations with faculty about this, there are people who focus very much on the technology aspects of this. And then there are people who are just like, I need to be able to imagine how I'm gonna do this in ways that have less to do with the technology and have more to do with conceptualizing it. I think in the four case studies we have here today, we have some fantastic different ways that people have approached having face-to-face and remote students at the same time. And so I wanna tell you the way this is gonna work. Louise Burns from our TCGS center in London is gonna go first. And you'll see that each speaker in the Jamboard has a Jamboard page. And thank you to the website for allowing me to put some images on here. So what we're gonna ask people to do as they're listening is to post comments and questions on the Jamboard for that person. And then in the corner of each of those Jamboards is a CTLM fellow who's going to be monitoring the Jamboard so that when that person is done with their presenting, they're gonna say, hey, I've been looking at the Jamboard. There are two major questions here that we wanna talk about before we move on. It's not gonna get to everyone's question, but we're gonna have someone synthesizing in real time so that we can hear from people, get some of the key questions out and conversation out, and then there will be opportunities for a follow-up after this session. But that seems like the best way to get everything out on that people are thinking about and then have some time for engagement around particular questions. So each person is gonna have about 10 minutes and then some time for questions at the right after what they're talking about. And then we're gonna, at the very end, hopefully have a few more minutes for questions before we go today. So Louise, can I turn things over to you? And for those of you who are doing the case studies, the order is Louise and then Chris Mullin and then Richard and then Chris Cerski. And Chris Cerski, part of the reason you're at the end is that you have the most bells and whistles. And so we wanna make sure that people don't get freaked out at the beginning, but know that there are wonderful technological options for doing this work. Louise, can I turn things over to you?
Hi, Ellen, thank you. Hi, everyone. Just to say, Richard and I are going to present together. We're gonna co-present, if that's all right.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
But I'll tell you why, Ellen. I think it might make quite a nice narrative for everyone because we sort of worked similarly, but also differently. So if it's helpful, if you let me share my screen, we've actually put a visual together. Which we can share. If I
you
do that
be able
now,
to share. Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. Can you all see that? Picture of Richard in the classroom?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, great. So for those of you monitoring, I'm sorry, you're gonna have to monitor both me and Richard at the same time. So you're getting used to the all modes already. we thought it might be useful, Richard and I, if we just gave you a quick visual of what our classroom looked like, because I know you're all going into this environment. It was a bit different for us, of course, because we went into, I think it must have been our second lockdown. So things were at quite a heightened time of awareness of the virus. So because of this, we had a one-way system into campus and students had to make their way to their desk. You'll see crosses on the floor. That's where the desks were set and the chairs, and the students couldn't move from those positions. And we had all the doors open to it. And Richard and I were behind this plastic protector at the front of the class, which ourselves, but the students themselves had to stay masked. So those were our conditions. In terms of the technology, you might be able to see, but I'll just quickly point out. So you can see that we had a large screen on the wall, which was viewable by our live students. And then Richard and I had access to a monitor ourselves where we could share our screens and use the PowerPoint. And then there was a single camera, which was up in the corner, pointing down towards our teaching area. And it was quite a wide view. So they could see Richard where he is standing. They could see a little bit of the screen behind them. And I think they could see a little bit of the whiteboard, but I didn't use that. So just to help you see what conditions we were working in to help you visualize, I hope that's useful. And so what we decided to focus on was just quickly go through, as Ellen said, we've kept it to a kind of fine grained examples, but you can absolutely fire any questions at us afterwards. If you want to ask any wider questions, we're very happy to address those. And I'll start just by passing it over to Richard.
Hi. So we also were required to record our Zoom lessons as well. I'm not sure if that'd be something that you will be planning to do, but I kept forgetting to press record for Zoom. So I would be like halfway through the lesson and I haven't pressed record. So I'd have to press record. But there is a function on Zoom that as soon as Zoom opens, it starts recording. So I started using that in the end, so I didn't ever lose any lessons. So that's quite useful, because I actually forgot for a whole class and I was really, really annoyed at myself. But Louise, you've got something to add to this as well.
I was going to add very quickly that if you wanted to find out how easy it is for you to edit the recording, if it's necessary, there was a student who wasn't prepared and had a moment of panic, and it was recorded, and she was finding it very difficult, and I decided that I didn't want to post that on Canvas for everyone and for her. So what I did was I went back into the recording and I made a point of cutting that out, which I thought was absolutely right to do. So I just wanted to reassure you that I think that option is there for you.
And so we had to wear these as well, like some of you are wearing now. And you can hear the remote students in your ears, but the students in classroom can't hear what the remote students are saying. So you have to make sure that if you have a remote student ask you a question, that you repeat the question. And the same with the online students. If the in-house students, if they speak, the online person can't hear it because they can only hear you through your microphone. So you have to kind of repeat questions and answers to either the remote students or the in-house students as well. And sometimes that can get a little complicated because you kind of want to just carry on a conversation with either the student in your ear or the student in the classroom, but you have to keep remembering to repeat things. So in the end, sometimes you would kind of say, okay, this is just going to be a lecture, guys. There's going to be no kind of class discussion. But, you know, it worked out. I had a kind of a relatively small class. But if you have a large class, it will be quite sort of take a long time to keep repeating things. So maybe use the lectures kind of for the online things, and then have more seminars maybe in online where people can talk. And Louise, you had this problem too, didn't you?
I did have this problem. It was interesting because Richard had, I think, quite a large class for this situation. And I ended up having only two live students and the rest of mine were remote. So what I decided to do, and it was actually down to one of my students who really wanted to take this idea forward, was they brought in their laptops or their iPhones or iPads and their headphones, and they connected to the Zoom session so that they could hear the remote students at home and vice versa. And this way they were able to connect to each other. And I didn't have to repeat questions. They could sort of hear the questions and I was able to respond in real time. But again, I had a small class. So that's a lot to ask of a big class with a lot of tech. So you have to bear that in mind. The only troubleshooting I can suggest for that is if students don't like looking at themselves on the screen, it's understandable. It's a bit off-putting when you can see yourself on the screen. In the live classrooms, they can simply turn their camera off. It's up to you to decide the policies. But I thought that was a really interesting experiment and I thought it worked well. So I just wanted to share it with you in case that was something that might work for you.
Yeah, and then I encountered problems when I was showing YouTube videos in the lecture because you press the button and the you know the video would go, but then you'd have a student in your ear going, "We can't hear it. We can't hear it." So only the in-house students could hear it, and so you fiddled about with the computer, and then the students in your ear going, "Yeah, great, we can hear it now," but the students in-house couldn't hear it. So you have to kind of constantly keep playing with the tech, and hopefully this is something that you know you'll have lots of support with. So it took us ages to work out which was the right setting that both the online and the in-house students could hear, and sometimes that setting seemed to change with each lecture. But the setting was connected to the headphones rather than the computer. But it's something we managed to do. And by the fifth lecture, I knew exactly what to do. So both parties could hear. But it's great to have someone nearby. And I kind of echo what one of you kind of said before. It's really useful. We only had one classroom going at a time, and the tech person, Chris Brown, was right next door. I know, you know, in Glenside, it's going to be more of a problem. So it'd be great if you can get the support that you need. But we also kind of use other parts of Zoom, like chat, which Louise can talk about now.
Yeah, I mean, I found this. Of course, many of you are already using chat, but I thought I might just share with you what it was like in a remote situation, because it might be a bit odd to do that and when you're double tasking. But I found it a really useful tool in terms of student involvement, student discussion. It is easier to keep, as Richard said, I found this to a lecture only environment. But if you're more Socratic in your questioning, as I am, sometimes a student discussion is really important. And on chat, it really helped foster the sense of community. And students were actually quite unfazed by it. They didn't seem to mind at all that there was someone remotely and some in class. And the shy students, actually, I found they really came out of their shell on this as well. And another positive thing is what you're all doing here, where you encourage each other. And I think that's really nice to see in the classes, and students might be feeling a little bit uncomfortable in this new environment. So that sort of positive community, I thought really added to a much more relaxed atmosphere for everyone. So I say play with it if you're toying with the idea. Remember to set it to everyone publicly. This stops students from chatting to each other. And then they know that it's a complete, that everything they say is going to be broadcast to me and everybody else. And remind students of this. One student forgot that was happening. And when I turned on the chat to answer some questions, it was a really long thread about one student's problems with her sinuses and her noses. And I had to scroll through it. For quite a while, and it gave us all a laugh, but at the same time, just remember to remind students. If the sharing of the screen fails, which can happen in these tech situations, one great way of using chat was just to very quickly post the video. I needed them to watch in chat, and I said, "Everybody watch this, then we'll talk about it." And also, if there was something I really wanted to share with students on the back of a question or something I remembered, I could throw a link in on chat. We do that anyway, but it works fine in the all remote situation. And you can set Zoom to actually save the chats as well. That was a function that I found. And it was quite useful for one session where there was a lot of good questions that were coming out. I think that's it.
And then finally, I think all modes doesn't mean that you have to be in the classroom and remote at the same time. So even though I did my lectures in front of a live audience with the remote students in my ears, other classes were completely online. And so that was a way of getting discussion because, like I said, my lectures are quite long and I didn't really have the time to repeat all the question and answer. And so then I would use an online seminar where everyone could speak. And so everyone is in the same boat. And I think that's a way of doing it. So you don't have to, if an almost doesn't mean that you have to be in two places at once. You know, you can have live lessons and also you can have online lessons as well, where all the students participate. And I think that's a way of looking at all modes rather than them both ways. And I think that's it. We did quite well in the end. It was a bit scary to begin with, but after 6 weeks, I think we were getting quite good at it. And as Louise said, the students were very supportive because they knew how difficult it was as well. So you know, they were great. Thank you.
Thank you so much, both of you. I think we're gonna hear from, I think it's Brittany who was paying attention to the questions on Louise's Jamboard. Brittany, do you wanna pose a few there?
Yes, we have the questions for Louise and Richard are primarily about the chat function. And so people are interested to know, first of all, sort of the back end of how you set chats to be public only. I also did not know that it was possible to make it so that people could only communicate to everyone. And so that's one question. And then the other question is about, again, the chat function. Did you have both face-to-face and remote students using the chat? Because students had laptops or iPads and were logged into Zoom also. So was it something that both sets of students were using?
So yes, I had both remote students and live students logged into chat, which was another benefit of having those live students with the headphones. You'll have to talk to Tim about how to set it publicly. I can show you now, but because I'm not a host, and don't make me one, that's okay. But if I recall, it's quite simple. You simply click on the three dots where the chat is there, where the chat is, and you can, you've got options to set the chat publicly or set the chat to everyone. So it is quite straightforward is what I'm saying. It's easy to find. And yes, I had both students on the chat. And I'll tell you why. Before the students came in, the live students with their headphones, I was having to not only repeat the questions in my ear, but also repeat the chat. So it was another way of keeping a much more sense of community from all sides. I hope that's helpful. And yes, somebody's just mentioned designating a student in the class to monitor the chat. That's absolutely a great thing to do. In fact, one of our colleagues came in and did that at first when we tried it. And then I said, maybe we should hand it over to students so that they've got that sense of ownership for the classroom.
Are there any other comments or questions for Richard and Louise before we move on? Okay, well, thank you. And we may come back to you as we hear some of the examples from Chris Mullin and Chris Cerski. And I have to say, one of the thrills for me of this year is how much easier it's been to hang out with TCGS folks who are in different parts of the world. So thank you to all of the TCGS folks who are here. Let's turn things over to you, Chris Mullin.
Hi, everybody. So I'll just tell you a little bit about me. I did prepare some slides. I'm not really sure if they're necessary. They kind of help keep me on track and just give you an idea. So can you see those? Okay, so I'll just share a little bit about my experience. So my class was a little bit different. Just to give you some background first, the course that I did in a hybrid model was Intro to Public Relations. And it was actually the very first time I taught this course. I don't know what I was thinking doing it in this manner for the very first time, but it ran Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 12:15 to 1:20. There were 20 students in the class. There were 8 who were approved to be on campus and had the option to attend in person, but I only had 5 that regularly attended. And there were different reasons for that. While there were some who I think woke up some days and just decided they didn't want to make the trek from Oak Summit, there were some, you know, one student who got sick during the semester and had to switch to remote for part of it. So there was some of that, but in general, I had about 5 students in front of me and then the rest were on Zoom. So usually about 12 to 14 on Zoom on Wednesdays. My class was held in Murphy 117 and the setup was not ideal. You're gonna hear from Chris Cerski, which I just heard about. I had no idea that some of this other technology was available. For me in Murphy 117, there was just the one camera that was mounted on the wall. And it monitored me at the front of the room. I could zoom in a little bit and zoom out, but it did not have the option to see the students in the class. There was the central microphone in the class that picked me up so that the students that were on Zoom could hear me. And sometimes, so if a student in the classroom, the physical classroom was speaking, the students online could hear them, but I found it was usually depending on how deep the voice was. If it was a more soft-spoken student, they usually couldn't hear it, so that if a student in the classroom spoke or asked a question, I would often repeat it just to make sure that the students on Zoom could hear it. One thing that was really important to the students who attended regularly is that they asked me in the very beginning, am I gonna have to sit in front of you and look at Zoom and be on Zoom? And the answer to that is yes and no. So when I was just speaking or when I was doing a lecture, the students in the classroom were not logged into the Zoom. They could see the Zoom on the screen with the faces of the 12 students who were coming in. But the students on Zoom could not see the students in the class. They could hear the students in the class. The students in the class could hear the students on Zoom, no problem, because that came through the speakers in the classroom, which is how I heard them as well. I did not wear headphones so that everybody in the classroom could hear it. And then, like I said, the students in the Zoom could hear me based on where I stood. The microphone is in close proximity to me. So I did ask the students to move up a little bit in the classroom. And most of the time, the students on Zoom could hear and pick it up from them, but sometimes they could not, depending on if the student was particularly soft-spoken, as I said. So my class did not meet every day in this hybrid format, just to give you an idea. I tried to stay as close as possible to our schedule. Monday was completely asynchronous, where students listened, watched a pre-recorded lecture on Panopto about the week's materials. They did an assignment where they were asked to comment on what they heard and what they read, what surprised them, that kind of thing. And then what I did is I took that material and I sort of synthesized it, kind of like what we're doing in the Zoom, where if there was a lot of repeat questions, I would always start our Wednesday class with that. And that was the synchronous day. So you had the option, if you were approved to be on campus, to meet in Murphy 117, or you came in through Zoom. And one of the level class, it is our first course in our public relations concentration. So a lot of the students were first and second years. And as Jeff mentioned in the beginning, they have never been on campus. They haven't really had a chance to meet people. And I kept hearing that again and again. So something that was really important for me is to make sure to sort of in some way embed a way so that the students could talk to each other. That kind of happens when, you know, you're just in the classroom before or after or walking to class or things like that. So the most essential tool that I found on our synchronous day was a combination of the breakout rooms with the Jamboard. And I'll show you some examples of that in a minute. So I would primarily use the synchronous day to just go over the material for the week with them. And then we would move into these breakout rooms and Jamboard sessions. Fridays varied each week. Sometimes we would meet, sometimes it was asynchronous. It depended on what was happening. One thing, and I don't think that this will be as essential in the fall, since we are hope that the majority of the students will be on campus. But one thing that I found really critical is I built right in conferences with me that mostly happened one-on-one, usually only about 10 to 15 minutes, but it allowed me to get to really know them on a more individual level. I also polled the students and I did it in two ways. I asked them, you know, how is class going for you? Is it awkward with that, can you hear everything, things like that. And then I also did an anonymous survey too for those who don't want to say negative things to me in a conference or things like that. So that's just a background. I was not in class in you know, having in person every single day. It was really primarily one day a week, sometimes 2 days a week, depending on the course. So the things that I learned, and I have the bad here, maybe the better word is challenging in doing this. Some ways it was a lot harder than I expected. And I think a lot of that had to do with the setup of my room in the sense that I did not have the benefit of having a second monitor. And I think Murphy 117, it was difficult to do that in that room. So I share my screen a lot. And when I go to share the screen, I cannot see the people on Zoom anymore, or I can, but just a panel. So that was pretty difficult, I think, and it took a lot of getting used to. Something that was really important to me is one of the primary courses that I teach in our department is speech communication. So I spend a lot of time talking about presentation skills, and it's really difficult figuring out where to look when you've got five students in front of you who are obviously who you are addressing, but also there's a camera mounted on the wall a little bit above eye level. So kind of switching back and forth. And it's the same thing if you're in a classroom, you obviously can't look at every student at every time, but really getting used to that idea of trying to make sure that everybody felt included by things like eye contact. So that was really important and took a lot of time to get used to. So I already talked a little bit about the setup of the room where I was in. So I'm happy to hear that, like Tim said earlier, most of the classes will be set up with the second monitor. And that is really essential to be able to see everybody while you are presenting and if you're sharing a screen or things like that. And I know Louise and Robert just talked about the chat. For me, it was a lot of multitasking overload. And I don't mean to scare you because it's something that I just got used to, but in the beginning, it was really challenging. Some things it's hard to manage. I don't know what it will be like in the fall, whether we're still gonna be masked. I was masked in front of the class and all students in the class were required to also use masks, to have masks on. So you can't really see facial expressions. That took a little bit to get used to, something to, I guess, be prepared to in some ways. Those that are on camera, like I said, I couldn't see their facial expressions or things like that along those lines. And I just found the chat to be kind of difficult all around because also when I was sharing my screen, the chat doesn't, although it would pop up, I'm also talking, monitoring a couple other things. So I would always tell the students, you can always feel free to write in there, but just know that I'm not ignoring you. And that you can always interrupt me, just unmute and ask. But I did find that a little bit challenging. And again, it is something that I got used to as the semester went on. Something that I didn't put on here as well is that when the network went down, then it became, I had to switch to all Zoom for about 2 or 3 weeks. I also came in one day and there was no computer in the classroom. And it was because they were upgrading them, but it wasn't back in time. So I had to use my laptop and then it wouldn't connect to the larger speaker. I called, Tim had mentioned Phil, who was great, came up to class in the beginning, showed me the whole system. And the day that I had trouble, I called IT. He was up there within 10 or 15 minutes, brought a bunch of wires and things to try to connect my laptop to the system, but it didn't work. So I ended up having to teach to my laptop, even with the students in front of me in the class as well. So there were some snags, but nothing that I think was too terrible. So let me end with the things that I thought were really good and the things that I learned, that it was really possible, I felt. I'm awaiting the student responses from the surveys or the, what are they called? Student evaluations. So I'll be anxious to read more about those, but I did, like I said, poll the students throughout the semester, just anonymously, how is this going? Do you feel like this is working? And all of the feedback was very positive, which was great to hear. And there, it was possible to generate discussion in both small groups and large groups. So that was really great and rewarding. So I thought I would just show you an example of some of the things that I used. So on those Wednesdays, like I said, I would start class with just a lecture answering the questions, but then depending on the topic that week, I would put them into breakout rooms and create a Jamboard. And I'll just show you some examples based on, so like I said, this was an introduction to public relations class. So they would have about 15 to 20 minutes in small groups. I had 20, so it would be a group of either 5 groups of 4 or 4 groups of 5. And that is when the students in the classroom would put on their headphones and they would log into the Zoom when we moved into the breakout rooms, which allowed them to then talk individually in these breakout rooms to the students on Zoom. So that was the only time that they would log into the Zoom call for my class. So this week we were talking about the entertainment, sports, tourism, health, and education industries in terms of public relations. And so I would give them a task. And so they would, for example, they had to look at the sports teams in Philadelphia and look at their community outreach. So this group obviously had the Eagles and, you know, they wrote all of the ways that they did community outreach and suggested things that they could do more. They are also looking for jobs and internships. And then I would post this Jamboard on Canvas so that it became a record and students could go back and look at it and things along those lines. What was great about using this as well is that I could monitor the Jamboard while they were off in their breakout rooms. So I could see while they're still really adding to here. So this group for 76ers did this. And I could see that, you know, the conversation is still really flowing or nobody's written on it in a while. Let's bring them back. And then we would have the large group discussion based on whatever they were doing. Here's another example when we were talking about radio and television for public relations. And I gave them a case activity where they had to come up with an idea to sell peanut butter and around community relations. So they were given a case activity and then they came up with sort of mini plans about what they would do to create peanut butter and things along those lines. So I think that is it. That was just some of the highlights of things that I did. I'm not sure if there are any questions that I can answer at this point.
Hey, Chris. So there's a few questions. Thanks so much for sharing that great information. I think one is around that you were speaking about the having the screen on the wall. So the question is around if everyone's in Zoom with a large wall mounted screen, at the front of the room, does that mean that everyone will have access to the visuals and the faces of everyone even on the sidebar, even if the student doesn't have a microphone or a headset.
Exactly. So everybody in the class sees what I see on the monitor in the classroom, which is projected onto the screen. And then I would always share my screen because the camera doesn't pick up the overhead projector as well, so that the students on Zoom then could see it. And that's why I shared my screen a lot.
And did you ever have any issues with the audio?
No, actually I didn't. That was something that I was really worried about. The only issue that I did, you know, have, it was hard for me. I'm soft-spoken myself. Yeah. And with the mask, it garbles your voice even more. So I was really worried about that. But the students all reported that they could hear me fine. When a student that was in the physical classroom spoke who was soft-spoken, sometimes it was hard. So I would just always repeat what they said.
Great. That's an awesome tip. There's one that's a common fail. I'm going to turn it into a question about the benefit to have guest speakers from around the world be able to come in is easier than ever. So I don't know if you incorporated any of that or thought about how that could have been incorporated into your class.
Guest speakers?
Yeah.
So not in this class, but in my other class, which did not run fully online, but we, you know, had guest speakers from the public relations industry all around Philadelphia weekly for the one class. And that was really great to have that opportunity as well.
Awesome. And so one more question that I'm gonna throw out there for you. It's really great to hear about the breakouts that included both the F2Fs and the online students. So it seems like that was a key learning strategy that you incorporated and it helped with building community. Are there any specific things you had to do to make this work well?
Just a lot of planning, you know, like with everything else. I know that you can all appreciate it. It's just really thinking of engaging activities that they can do that I also tried to make them useful. So like I said, then I would save the Jamboard in the sense that, so like sometimes if we were talking, like for example, when we were talking about public relations in the tourism industry, like maybe in one of their breakout sessions, they could see a certain case study or look it up. And so then that work would be recorded and put on there. So it was a lot of preparation. The textbook that I used for class did help in having some activities that I would pick and choose and sort of make my own. But it's just a lot of planning, and I worked harder on this than any other, you know, class out there, because you're also like, you know, recording the lectures, responding to every student on the assignments. And it was just a lot of work, but it did work. I found that it did work particularly for my class, which was nice.
Thanks, Chris. Really appreciate all the insights that you've shared. Really wonderful.
I just want to note that there is a question on Chris's Jamboard that's a more general question that let's get to at the end. So let's hold on to that. Without further ado, let's turn things over to Chris Cerski, who I think many of you have heard about the myth and the legend of what he's been doing, but a quick view into how he's been handling face-to-face and remote students at the same time. And Ned Wolf sent me the link to the longer video, and I will also post it here and also get it posted on the website. So if you really want to see more detail about how he made the room work, you'll be able to do that too. Chris, thank you so much for being here.
So good morning. So first I thought I would start by telling you that during Zoom time, I teach Socratically, so I was able to teach on Zoom, but my energy level with regard to the classroom just was missing. As soon as I came back in the physical classroom, even though it was in an all modes version, my energy level and the students' energy level, both on Zoom and in the classroom, went through the roof, and it felt much, much more normal per se. As a matter of fact, many of my colleagues over the past couple of weeks have been saying that, you know, they can't wait till the semester is over being on Zoom. They've been fatigued out. Whereas for me, I was like, oh, this semester was fine. I had no problems with this semester at all. I started the semester teaching one class 3 days a week on Zoom, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And then my second class, which was not designated as an all modes class, the students, about 8 to 10 of the students actually asked to create and designate that class as all modes as well. And so after the midterm, we moved that class to an all modes. So the beginning of April, I started teaching all modes 5 days a week for both of the classes that I'm teaching. You know, when I started teaching this, if you remember way back when we first went on the emergency online, the university thought it was only going to be 2 weeks, and they encouraged us 2 days before spring break to kind of experiment with all modes. And so I took that opportunity to actually teach from the classroom. I didn't do a traditional Zoom. And much like Chris, I had no confidence board in the back. I had no ability to look at the students. And that was really a rude awakening for me at that time. So when I agreed to do the all modes in the spring, I met with ATS to have a conversation that I really thought that I needed something in the back of the room to be able to have a conversation with the students. It would also then untether me from the podium because I don't typically lecture from the podium. I teach Socratically, so I'm constantly questioning them, and I walk around the room. And so to be tethered to the podium, which was really problematic for me. So I actually set up multiple cameras in my room. We had the one camera that's provided by the university. I then used my iPhone and put it in the corner of the room, facing the faces of the students that were in the room, particularly because the students, the in-person students, I met with them before we came back to class, and they did not have an interest of logging on to Zoom in the classroom. They really just wanted to focus on the classroom itself. And so I then projected the Zoom students in the front of the classroom on the screen. And then I had what was called a D10 board, which is like a big iPad for Zoom in the back of the room. And so I will tell you that this setup just naturally just kind of worked. All of a sudden, the students in person and online started interacting with each other. The personality started to come out within the classroom itself, both online and in the physical classroom. And it just started to provide a much better environment. I have a few pictures that I thought I could show you. So this is me addressing one of the other students, but as you can see, you know, the classroom podium is over in the back. I'm not at it. I typically teach from a lectern in the middle of the room. I'm speaking with one of the students in the classroom. I have the Zoom students in the back of the room as if they're just sitting in the back of the room. And then, you know, now you can see I'm actually facing forward talking to one of the Zoom students. Now, fortunately for me in this particular classroom, since I had the D10 board, they also had a camera view from the D10 board. So when I would be speaking to them, it was, you know, face forward right to them. As Tim goes through and puts the new confidence boards in, I'm assuming they're going to be put somewhere where the cameras are so that it'll look like you're looking at the students. This is, as you can see, the Zoom students were on the screen. So my students would be able to then look at the Zoom students as they were speaking. But I also found that just naturally, a lot of them would turn around and look at the confidence, well, look at the D10 board in the back. And then an interesting thing that kind of came about, which was not by design, you'll notice in this picture, I have students taking a paper. This is my final exam for this class. They're taking a paper exam. And then I have the other students online. The students in the classroom wanted to take a paper exam. They did not want to do an online lockdown browser exam. And so I said, that's fine. You can come into the classroom. It'll be the same exam, but I'll have you do it by paper. Everyone else did it online. My other class, they all wanted to do it online, but the in-person students asked if they could come in and not use the lockdown browser. And so I allowed them to do that, and I just had them sit backwards so I could see their screens at all time. And then I sat in the front of the room and was able to observe all of the students on the exam from the Zoom. I also thought I would just quickly share with you. So in my business law class, they do a project where they have to do an oral argument. And I require them to meet with me, but to get them to meet with me sometimes is a bit of a task. And so after I have one or two students actually meet with me, I then call on them in class and have them tell the rest of the class whether it was helpful or not. This is that conversation, but it'll give you just a look into, I would call on someone from Zoom and then I would call on someone from the classroom. You will also actually hear the problem from the one student in the classroom who spoke softly, like Chris was referring to, that's very hard to pick up, but then the other person. So I'll let it play for like a minute or so. Oh, you know what? I think I didn't.
Chris, it's good to know I'm not the only one.
I always forget that.
Everybody else put their microphones on too. All right, so
that's another thing I did pretty religiously is I would have all of the students on Zoom put their microphones on at all times throughout the class, unless there was some type of background noise. That way I could call on them immediately and there was none of this like delay of them trying to find the microphone button, and it just created a more fluid conversation.
What do you want to tell the class?
We wanted to say that you should schedule your meetings with Judge for the debate as soon as possible, because it helped us out a lot with our project already.
Islande? Yeah. Sam? Speak loudly, Islande. Scream. Sam?
Yeah, whatever you think you did, if you think it's not, I'll pick you apart, break you down, tell you what you have to do to be better.
Marissa?
It was very, very helpful, and I think you guided us in the right way.
And so you can kind of see what I did there was almost do like a round robin where I would go back and forth. And I would do that in all of my classes, both of the classes on a regular basis, where I would consciously call on the people in Zoom and then call on the people in the classroom. I also have this thing where I'll call on students and tell them to call on other students and try to create some camaraderie in the classroom. And so I would do that, you know, an in-person student, I would tell, say, to call on someone on Zoom, or vice versa, someone on Zoom, call on the in-person student. Now you'll notice I said in the video, Islande, speak loudly, yell, because for several weeks, it was always a problem with that particular student in particular. She sat in the back of the room. She speaks very softly. She also is a foreign student, and so she has a bit of an accent, and that the mask and the speaking softly just created it to be a little bit more difficult. I will tell you, I've heard several questions about bringing people in. I have an oral argument exercise in my constitutional law class, and it kind of went on hiatus while we were on Zoom because it didn't work well. And so this semester, for the first time, I brought it back, and I was able to do it in an all modes format. My colleagues from the court were on Zoom because they weren't allowed to be here, and I was in person, and then the majority of my class came in person, those that were cleared to be on campus. Things to think about, some of the things were already said, you know, repeating what the students said. I didn't do it in that particular instance because that wasn't actually a part of the lecture. Purposely calling on students in both the Zoom and the classroom. The chat for me was just too difficult. It's actually too difficult even if I'm just on Zoom. I don't ever pay attention to it. The other thing that I did want to make the students well aware of is if they were chatting something, it goes up on the screen in front of all of the students that are in the room. And so I think I actually had the private chat on where they can private chat with me, but if they did, it was being broadcast to the entire room. Like I said, I used the microphones on for all students. I also required all of the students to have their video on, unless there was a very particular reason. I mean, if a student emailed me and said, look, I'm XYZ problem today, that would be no problem. Some challenges. So I like to write on the board occasionally. I like to draw things out quickly. That I originally tried to have the camera in the room zoom up on the whiteboard, but the like shine of the whiteboard, it didn't pick it up correctly. So then what I started doing was those big pieces of paper with like the post-it note thing. I would post that on the whiteboard. That actually worked fairly well to zoom in and use those. But then I also used the iPad. Hold on 1 second, I'm just gonna. Well, I was gonna show you the iPad, but I have to register in order to get into the meeting, so that's not gonna work. So I did use the iPad to then write on sometimes. The D10 board also had a nice whiteboard, so sometimes I would just go to the back of the room and write on the D10 board, but we're not gonna have that capability with those conference boards. The microphones in the room, this is like something that until you're actually in the room and in reality, you don't realize sometimes it happens. But in Brubaker, you know, there's all of that lawn across the little roadway going towards Stuytler. Well, I teach at 2:45, and for whatever reason, facilities cuts that grass at 2:45, like once a week. And so under normal circumstances, if the room is air conditioned, it's not too warm out, and the windows are closed, it's not that big of a deal. But there were a couple occasions where I had to have the windows open, and fighting the lawnmower is one thing to just speak over it, but then the combination of the lawnmower and the background noise, or me and the background noise, really created a problem for the Zoom people. And so I had to be a little bit more cognizant of that. I would suggest that if you have the opportunity to really come in the summertime and play around with the room that you're assigned to, you know, have one of your friends maybe log in, make sure you can hear, test out things. Also have ATS come and show you exactly what speakers you have to activate and what camera you have to activate, because there's like a short list of them and sometimes they default to the wrong one. And so then you get into your class and it's coming up with a blue screen and you're trying to figure it out, and literally it's just a small adjustment. There was a couple of times, and I learned this through the text that came over, that the camera just didn't work. And so literally I just had to go in the back of the room and unplug it and then plug it back in, and then it would reset itself and it would be fine. I saw Abby Ryan is on this call. I don't know if we're gonna continue with the LibCal. So for this semester, students had to register for the desk that they were at, and then you had to approve them and sign in. That was a complicating factor that I wish I didn't have to do. I understand why I had to do it this semester, but invariably the students would always forget. And so I would always be asking them to LibCal in when they first came into the room. And it took, you know, like 5 minutes of my class time in order to get the LibCal all ready for them. And so, you know, overall, I had a really good experience with all modes. The way that I teach worked. I recognize that some of you, it would be very different. But if the provost said tomorrow we're going to be all modes and recruiting more students that way, it, for me, it would be absolutely fine, as long as you have access to the technology. And so I'm happy to answer any questions or have a broader discussion. Ellen, I don't know if you wanted me to cover anything else.
Yeah, I think Daniel is going to help ask a few of the questions from the Jamboard.
Yeah, there are a few questions on there. There was something interesting where the questions were being posed and then almost telepathically you were answering them, Chris. So you may be speaking to things that you've already spoken to, but someone asked if you had students participating in the chat. You mentioned you didn't. I wonder if there were other ways you had them like communicating either via Jamboard or if everything was accomplished audibly.
Yeah, so everything for me was accomplished just using the basic Zoom. I didn't use breakout rooms. But to be perfectly honest, for these two classes that I teach, I don't typically break students down into any type of group work. I did do a review session where I still accomplished it, but we do a Jeopardy. And normally, under normal circumstances, I would break them down into groups. But in order to do that, I would have had to put them in separate rooms so they couldn't hear each other talking. And so I just modified it and had called on each one of the people, and then they could compete using their cell phones and texting me certain code words. And so I can explain that more in detail if someone has a particular question about that. But that was a little bit more difficult, but in the end worked. I just kind of made it work.
And then the other question here is about visuals. I know you talked a little bit about using the whiteboard and the D10 board. Just how successful, I guess, were the visuals that you used?
Yeah, the visuals were fine. And so for my business law class, which I started to teach the second half of the semester, one of the real reasons I started to teach it the second half was because I use hypotheticals that we discuss in class. And so I constantly have the hypothetical posted on the screen in the front. And when we're using Zoom, obviously I'm sharing my screen. And so for the first half of the class, the D10 board's software didn't allow me to see all of the students. It would just superimpose the shared screen. And so it defeated the whole purpose of having that board in the back. I mentioned that to Matt Pellegrini, and then he called the D10 people, and they like got an update together really quickly and issued it out. And then the next thing you know, the D10 board was allowing me to change the view. And so I was able to then put everybody in the back, but yet still use the shared screen. And that worked great, which is when then I switched the entire class over to all modes.
That's great. Thank you so much. Someone just added, did you use slides at all in particular in terms of the visuals? Yeah.
Yeah, so that was the PowerPoint.
And there is another question here. I feel like it's another one of the kind of broader generic questions like the one that was on Chris Mullin's slide. So Ellen, you just wanna wait and address that now in the last like 15 minute wrap up?
Well, we're just about there. One of my challenges, I've never used a D10 board. I don't know how it's different from a confidence board, or is it a confidence monitor? I would keep getting it wrong. So I think it might be beneficial, Tim, if you could just say a little bit about like this terminology. And I've heard you talk about how a confidence monitor really is just like any of us who have like a laptop and another screen on our desks that we can show different things on different screens. But could you just say a little bit about that?
Yeah, so the conference monitor is basically a large TV screen that's going to be in the back of the room. It's literally just going to be an additional monitor that could, if you're not using Zoom, could be used literally as another monitor that you can run your presentation off of, so you can see, you know, your notes. So if you do teach facing the class and don't have to keep turning your head back to look at the screen to see what's on the screen for your notes or something like that, it's there for you. For that. What Chris was talking about in terms of the D10 board, the D10 board is a separate piece of hardware that we had a couple on campus with, and we were testing out. We thought about using those in every room, but the issue with that is they become very costly because each one requires its own separate service as well. You know, so it's an annual service cost to utilize those as well. And this feature that we're doing enabled us to do a lot more classrooms and a lot more setups across. So we have a lot more capability of supporting everybody in teaching this way.
And my understanding, right, Tim, is that that amazing thing that Chris Cerski has been able to do, where he can see all of the face-to-face and remote students at the same time, and they can interact, will be possible with these confidence monitors as well, right? So that's what's going to allow it.
The reality is, Ellen, I didn't use the D10 board's capabilities to its full extent anyway. I primarily only used it as a confidence monitor for the most part.
Okay, great. So we will, 40 classrooms on campus will have that capacity by the end of the summer. There's a question in the chat right now about people needing to move from room to room on campus. Tachan, do you want to say something about that? And I hear Marianne is having a similar concern.
I just, in past, there were troubles with technology, you know, from room to room. So I just wonder if setup will be the same in all the buildings, in all the rooms. Podiums were different to begin with, right? So it'll create some problems, I believe.
So some of the technology in the podiums, yeah, it's basically the same technology. The hardware that's there has changed from year to year when we replace stuff. So like that's stuff that we want to make sure we address with you know, the checklist and things like that, what we talked about possibly having at the podium. So hopefully we'll be able to handle those kind of things. But yes, every podium has some slightly different technology in it in terms of like the touch panel that you would turn it on. Some might actually have physical buttons. Some might be an actual like LCD screen that you touch. all have the same functionality, you know, but it's aesthetics. They're different because they're different versions of that same kind of touch panel. We just, as we continue to do, yes, the laminated cheat sheets are going to be hopefully making that comeback. And we'll continue to work through each of those things. So yeah, the podium images themselves, one of the other things that we're working on, I know there's been concern in the past about how the length of logging into those machines sometimes has caused issue at the podium. So we do have a fix in place, hopefully for that, for this fall coming in. So we're going to be basically re-imaging every podium machine to a new image. We had to do that anyway with the security breach. We had to create all new images for all new machines on campus due to that. But what that does is, and I can kind of give you a 5-second explanation as to why it took so long. We have a program called Deep Freeze, which freezes computers at a specific state. And what would happen was it would be deep frozen for the entire semester. You would log in once. It takes some time to load your profile, depending even on how much of your network shares you have. Like if you have a lot of files in your shared drives, that takes time to load into every machine that you log into. So that's why it always seemed like it took so long. And then when you restarted the machine, your profile was wiped away because of the deep freeze program. So the plan is for the first 2 weeks of camp of the semester is to have those podium machines not frozen, so that when you log in one time, it'll load into your, that podium machine. So if you're, you know, we would suggest within that first 2 weeks, get to those classrooms that you're going to be teaching and log into those machines. Because after the first 2 weeks, we'll then refreeze them, but your profiles will be stored on those machines. So they'll be there as you go back, and it should take far less time, for you to log in to each machine when you get to that class at the beginning of class. I hope that made a lot of sense, or did I just confuse people?
So Tim, would there be a single sign-on, or there's still multiple sign-ins on a machine, and then Canvas, and then maybe you need Zoom sign-in?
Everything should be single sign-on. Your password that you use to get into PortalGuard should be the same password you use to log into your computer, should be the same password as everything now. So everything should be squared away with that, where we, again, had that, you know, the security issue, we had some issues where pieces of our technology came down, which meant we lost the ability to have single sign-on across things until we got everything kind of, where things back up. We're almost there fully. We still have things that we're pulling back together as we continue to go. But all of that sign-on stuff should all be tied together now. So you should have that same password across all devices and all applications.
I wanted to just take a minute to talk about support. And this has been, I have found it so helpful to hear the very specific ways that different people have made different choices based on their goals in the classroom, their styles of teaching, whether to use chat or not use chat, the ways people are using breakout rooms or not. But I think what it points out is that each of us have some thinking to do about how the having face-to-face students and remote students at the same time, how that maps on to like how we teach. If you look at the Jamboard slide on page 6, it includes like reminding you that like the help desk email is the best email to use if you have particular questions about classrooms and setups. Of course, the mail is here. Why don't I shift over to Lindsay for a second? Can you talk about the departmental support?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm gonna put a link in the chat, which goes to a Google form that we've previously sent out, but for people to incorporate, you know, one of the things that we really want to be able to do with the all modes is understand that this is really can be really specific to departments and department needs and the different type of learning strategies that you have specific to your students and to the classes that you're teaching. So with that in mind, the Center for Teaching, Learning, and Mentoring and the Digital Learning Services are partnering together to try to offer more engaging collaborative teaching and learning sessions in July. And so what we're thinking about is trying to engage with departments specifically about your particular needs, about the ideas, about the concerns, in a way that we can really tailor the work that's being done over the summer, and in a way that kind of really gets to the core of what's most needed, and to be specific to the particular teaching and learning and mentoring type of things that is going on specifically to each department. So if you, some of you already have filled out this form, but for others, you know, the idea is that we could have a first initial session to meet with the department, each department, to find out what those most, those needs are, and to share the successes that you already have to build on. And so we're thinking about that late May, early June. And then we'd have second sessions in June or July, where the department's participating in workshops and sessions around particular topics that are around those kinds of engagement and support and information that are specific to departments, with the idea that there might be departments that can partner with one another, that you see a commonality in the way that you're engaging with your students or the learning, and you might learn from one another and the type of tips and engagement that you need. And then the third sessions, which would be in August, are those additional engagement, support, and information sharing. You know, there's a lot just from we saw, you know, from Chris and our wonderful colleagues in London, there's a lot to learn from the people that are around us, and that the capacity that they've already built, or the successes and the challenges and the things that we can learn from one another. So we find that those collaborative spaces can be really beneficial as well. So the idea is to really go off of a more specific and strategic, stratified effort with regards to engaging in the all modes conversations versus just the a general here are places that we think. So yeah, Alan, with there anything else you want to share with regards to that?
Yes, I was just going to say, I'm wondering if DLS has anything that they want to share. And then I got a private message from Tori saying, could I have a minute to let people know what DLS has for the summer? So we are in sync, Tori.
Great. I just wanted to let you know, we're still in the process of working some things out, but we have a plan. And I think Valerie is about to put the link into the chat. So we're changing things up a little bit because we know workshops and the timing and dates might not work for you. So we have one-on-one sessions available every day, Monday through Friday, from about 9 to 3. Occasionally, if you sign up for one, we may need to move it around, but we'll communicate directly with you. And so we have that for May and June as well. So we will be available for you as you need. So if that helps, we hope that eases a little bit of, oh, well, I don't know when they're available. So you'd be able to sign up for a half an hour time slot, but you can also sign up for two if you needed an hour or something like that. And you can come back, of course, multiple times. So we'll be here then. We also in July, we have all modes drop-in sessions that we're going to have. They were just 1 hour, but a little bit more specific to the teaching that you've been doing and what you're going to look forward to in the fall, using the technology in the class, using all of the other tools and resources that we have available for you through Arcadia. And we're hoping that will be more of a discussion, and then we can follow up with one-on-ones if you have something a specific need or need something explained or trying something out with your Canvas course or your Zoom session. We also have employee technology support days, and this is going to be a little bit more broad to everyone at Arcadia. So with Portal Guard or things that are specific to your department, network drives, things like that, you know, anything that kind of comes up that you need support with, we're going to have a few of those. And then in August, we're also going to have fall prep days. So you can find that all on this list. You can sign up, and we are here all summer, and we will be here when you need us.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Tori, and Valerie, and all of your team. I want to just end by posing a sort of philosophical question that was posed on the Jamboard. That's kind of like, if a tree falls in the woods and no one's there, does it make a sound? Which is, if everyone is on Zoom, is there a benefit to having students face-to-face in the classroom? And I'm asking Chris and Louise and Richard, just as a closing, how would you answer that question? Let's maybe go in order. Louise, if everyone is on Zoom, is there a benefit to having students face-to-face in the classroom?
Yes, absolutely there is. You cannot beat having live students.
You can't beat having live students.
You can't, yes, absolutely. I mean, there's no, you have to have live students. You just can't beat it.
Great. How about you, Richard? How would you answer that question?
Yeah, we didn't sign up really, to agree to teach and to teach online. So we all love teaching face-to-face. And I think the students, you know, I'm not sure what's happening in the States, but in Britain, students are now suing their universities because there's not enough live classes. Because some universities have decided they're going to be online next term, next semester as well, the fall semester. And students are really angry about that. So it's not just us who like teaching online, you know, the students teaching live. Students want to go back to normality too.
And so even if half of your students are in the room and half of them aren't, it's still worth it.
Yeah, I enjoyed my doing that in the fall last term. It reminded me of why I'm doing the job.
Great. Chris Mullin, if everyone's on Zoom, is there a benefit to having students face-to-face in the classroom?
Yeah, I mean, for me, it was just getting back to some sense of normalcy, get away from my kids in my own house and be back in a classroom and things like that. But just a sense of, I don't know, the world before, it was really wonderful to get back to that. And I just, you know, although the mediated, you know, you can build that relationship online, it's still, in my opinion, better in person.
And Chris, you answered this a little bit at the beginning of what you were saying you feel like you have more energy than your colleagues, but I think that might be true always.
I don't know about that.
How would you answer this question?
But I absolutely, as soon as it went on, well, the one class that started that way, immediately I recognized a different dynamic in the classroom and my energy level and the students' energy level, both on Zoom and in person. Because the in-person students wanted to be there. The people on Zoom arguably chose to be on Zoom. This semester, maybe a little bit less so because they didn't have as much of a choice. The business law class, the one that I started halfway through, that had the majority of people on Zoom and only about a third of the class in person. And still, the dynamic change immediately was apparent, absolutely apparent. From both the Zoom students, I mean, the Zoom students would comment that this now feels like a real class, that they felt like they were back in the classroom, even though they were on Zoom.
So I want to say thank you all, each and every one of you, and thank you for doing this kind of transition from celebrating and finishing the spring to moving into the fall. This is just the beginning of conversations and support that will be happening throughout the summer, but many, many thanks to all of you. And I selected a little Barry Manilow to end our session. Thank you for coming today.
There you are, looking just the same as you did last time I touched you. And here I am, close to getting tangled up inside the thought of you.